Hi guys, welcome back to the channel. Today we're talking about how you can improve the texture of your film emulations by implementing a technique called an MTF. First, I'm going to explain what an MTF is, and then I'm going to show you two ways to emulate it in DaVinci Resolve. First, to understand what we're trying to replicate, let's review stills from projects captured on 16mm film. I've gathered an example from a music video, a commercial, and a film. If we look closely, we're going to notice that the overall texture feels soft. Now let's compare them to three stills that are captured on digital cameras. Do you notice how what is in focus looks much sharper? We can even see the pores of the actor in this example. If we wipe between this still from Beef filmed on an Arri Alexa Mini LF and this one from a movie called We Are Animals filmed on Arri 416, you can really see the difference between the amount of detail we can see on the right. Notice how sharp her glasses are. We can even see the pores in her skin. Whereas on the left, we don't have this level of detail. The features in his face are much softer and we can't really see a lot of detail in his beard and hair. Well, the reason is that one of the main characteristics the film prints is a loss of detail in high frequencies. And if you're wondering what high and low frequencies are in an image, let's review this example. Put simply, low frequencies are areas in the image that are plain where there is very little variation in pixels next to each other. For example, the yellow cardigan down here, the red seatbelt over here, the seat as well, and the skin tones. In contrast, high frequencies are areas where we see a lot of contrast between pixels next to each other. Typically, those would be fine details such as edges and textures. In this example, the detail in her lips, her eyelashes, the strings of hair, and the striped texture of the seat would live in the high frequencies. The loss of detail in high frequencies when recording on film is called MTF, which stands for Modulation Transfer Function. And if you look up the technical data of Kodak's 5222 negative, for example, you're going to be able to see the exact modulation transfer function curve that is applied. And notice how between 20mm to 100mm spatial frequency, the loss of sharpness intensifies. And so this is one of the main texture characteristics that makes films so beautiful. And that's enough theory for today. Let's dive into Resolve and see how we can create our own MTF. I'm using a clip from Red Dragon X and I've already set up my node-based color management. I have an IDT in my group pre-clip that takes us from red, white, gamut, log 3G10 to Arri log C3, as this is my preferred timeline color space. I have also applied some noise reduction and a bit of sharpening to compensate for the softness introduced by the noise reduction. And at the end of my pipeline, in my group post clip, I've applied Arri's technical LUT that takes us out to Rec 709 gamma 2.4. In my project settings, I've also ensured timeline color space is set to Arri log C3. On the clip level, I have applied a simple exposure and white balance adjustment, and I've taken advantage of the brand new Look Creator OFX with the default 35mm preset loaded. I've just turned off some of the effects such as halation, bloom, and grain, but everything else is left to default. Now let's dive into method number one, edge detect. I'm going to open up the Effects tab and search for Edge Detect. Let's apply it to our node. By default, the mode is set to RGB edges, but I'm going to switch it to grayscale edges. What Edge Detect does is it pulls a selection on the hard edges of our image and we can see the edges that are currently selected in white. As we already know, edges and areas of high contrast between neighboring pixels are the high frequencies of your image. So we can use Edge Detect to select which high frequencies exactly we want to blur later. So let's refine our selection. I'm going to reduce edge width because I want the area that I'm affecting to be more narrow. Gamma controls the threshold of the frequencies we're going to be affecting. Lower values select more frequencies and higher values select less. I'll keep tweaking until I'm happy with the selection and I think this looks good. Okay, so now we essentially have pulled a qualifier on our high frequencies. And here is how we can use this key to start blurring them. First, I'm going to create a new serial node and disconnect it from Edge Detect. I'll connect its input to our source image and I'll grab the output of Edge Detect and pipe it into the alpha input of my new serial node where I'm going to be doing the blurring. So I've just passed on the key we pulled to our new node and any corrections that we do in this node is going to affect these pixels in white. And we can confirm we've passed the key correctly by double checking our node key down here. Now that this is set up, let's start adding some blur. I'll open up the blur tab and start increasing the radius. I think right about here looks good to me. We've lost some of the sharp detail we had before, but we haven't affected the overall quality of the image, and to me, this brings us one step closer to a realistic film emulation. I'll grab a still of this and let's jump to method number two, custom MTF compound node. First, I'll create a new grade version and delete these two nodes. So with this method, we're going to build our own frequency separation tool with nodes. This may seem complex at first, but it's all going to make sense as we break it down. So I'm going to build out a node tree and then we're going to explain what each node does. Alright, so let's break this down. The first node is just an empty connection node, which is why I have labeled it null. Then our node tree spreads out into two separate branches. Let's start deconstructing it from the bottom. We already know that the MTF reduces detail in high frequencies, but how can we separate low from high frequencies without a null effect? Well, if we apply blur to our entire image, we'd only be getting low frequencies. This is because, as we said, low frequencies are areas that are plain with little detail. And the way to get less detail is to simply apply blur. So I've increased the radius in my blur tab to 0.56. Then I've taken the blurred signal and I've passed it onto the bottom node of a layer mixer structure. If we break down this layer mixer, we'll see that the node at the top does nothing. It only passes the information from the original image, and the bottom one is getting our low frequencies from our blurred image. Next, the composite mode of our layer mixer is set to a subtract operation. So essentially, we're taking the original image and we're subtracting the low frequencies from it. And as a result, what we get on the other side of the layer mixer is the high frequencies. And we can confirm this if we switch on highlight mode. Do you see the white lines? Similarly to what we saw with Edge Detect, these are the high frequencies. And we can control how much we are selecting by increasing or decreasing the blur in the low frequency threshold node down here. If we increase the blur further, we're going to be grabbing more high frequencies. And if we reduce it, we're going to be bringing down the threshold of our selection. And we can keep jumping between these two nodes in highlight mode and refine the selection until we're happy. Okay, so we have a selector down here, and this node is reserved for our blurring operation to the high frequencies. You're going to notice we have one more layer mixer at the end of our node tree, and its composite mode is set to add. We can see that it's getting one signal from the blurred image, hence the low frequencies, and another signal from our high frequencies that we haven't altered just yet. So the result we get is nothing. And this is because these two layer mixers essentially cancel each other out. Now that we've built what looks like a complex frequency separation tool, let's put it to work and let's start losing some detail in the high frequencies. Our aim is to soften the detail slightly, but we don't want to make the image look out of focus. I'll jump to my high frequency blur node here, and I'll start increasing blur to about 0.53. You can combine the effect with mid-tone detail as well, so let's decrease mid-tone detail slightly. Please note I'm overdoing it a little bit to make sure this is visible on YouTube. Okay, let's zoom out and see what we've done. If we disable and enable all the nodes, do you notice how we've defocused the fine details? Again, we're not affecting the overall quality, we're just adding some softness to the texture. But the effect is subtle and it's completely different if we were to apply blur to the entire image. In fact, let's compare the two so you can see the difference for yourself. I'm going to select all the nodes and create a new compound node. I'll label it MTF. Let's grab a still of this and disable the compound node. I'll create a new serial node and apply blur to the entire image. Let's wipe the still and see if there is a difference. Do you notice how our MTF is much more subtle and believable? The effect is only applied to the high frequencies, so we're not deteriorating the quality of the image. We're just giving it a more filmic look by emulating one of the key characteristics of film negatives, an MTF curve. I would advise you to save this compound node as a power grade so that you can quickly apply it to your node tree the next time you're asked to create a film emulation look. If you made it this far, thank you. I know this may have seemed like a complex topic, but hopefully now you have an understanding of how to better emulate the texture of film in your own work. As always, if you enjoyed this video, please like, subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you in the next one.